Well, good evening. It is May 24th, 2023, and it's time for our Wednesday evening devotions, our evening devotional here at Sanctuary Lakeside Church. And before I get started with the evening's program, we've been starting a program called Lights for the Lord. And I asked our listeners to call in or send in, text in, personal message in, whatever, or any acts of light that they have done. And for those of you that are new to our program or aren't aware of this, we just recently started a program called The Lights for the Lord, and we've challenged all of our listeners to each week to do one good deed, one good turn, one act of light, we're calling them, and that is just to do something nice or something helpful for someone else sometime during the week. And that could be something relatively simple. It can be something more involved. It can involve a monetary donation. It can involve to somebody to help them out when they're in need. It can involve some kind of work for that they may not be able to do themselves. It could be any number of things. It could be an encouraging word in the waiting line at the grocery store, something along that nature. And this week, I've had a couple of them come in. We had a fella that went across. He had a neighbor who's works doing auto repair in his side shop. And this week, one of our folks went over and cut his lawn for him because he'd been so backed up doing this work that he was having trouble finding the time to cut his lawn. So this across and cut his grass for him, or used a riding lawnmower, I guess. I don't know. But anyway, and also I had a message that one of our gals, who is a regular listener here, was at a gathering, and she made it a point to sit down with two elderly ladies in wheelchairs and visit with them during this. They were kind of off by themselves, and she just took it upon herself to go over and sit and have a nice visit with them. And so that's kind of on the order of things that we're encouraging. I want to thank those folks for letting us know about this. And I would encourage you to participate in our Acts of Light or Lights for the Lord program and perform some kind of act of light for somebody each week. And then please, 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 do as these folks did and share them with us so that we're able to share those with you and maybe give you some ideas of things you might try to do. So keep those things coming in, and we'll try and share a couple of those each week till you kind of get into the swing of things with this. But welcome, and we're so glad you're with us, and we have some great music to share with you this evening. We have some a nice prayer. We're going to stick with our prayers from the Psalms for a little while. And so we have one of those coming up and some good scripture and some other things. So just stay tuned, and we hope you find this evening meaningful in your walk with Christ. We're going to move right into our first song for the evening, and it is called Breathe. And I think you're going to love this, the beautiful video. So if you know the words, sing along. If not, listen, and I think you'll catch on, be able to sing along. We're still working on getting the words included. So hang in there with us.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day.
It's time for our evening prayer. I'm going to go back with you after I quit knocking things off the desk here. We're going to go back to our 100 prayers inspired by the Psalms by Julie Ackerman Link, published by the company of Daily Bread, Our Daily Bread Ministries, in 2017. And again, there is a website for our Daily Bread Ministries, and I'll try and get that up on the screen for you here at some point. But again, no kickbacks for us on this. We get nothing out of this. It's just a resource that we found helpful for us. And if you want one for yourself, you can get in touch with them, and I'm sure they can connect you with a way to get one of these for yourself. Today, our prayer comes from Psalm 49, verses 5 and 6, and that reads as follows. Why should I fear when evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me, those who trust in their wealth and boast of their great riches? So that's our Psalm for Dave, Psalm 49, verses 5 and 6. And here's the prayer for this evening. Let us pray. Forgive me, Lord, for thinking that you, to do your will, I need anything more than what you have given. My own hands to extend the love and kindness you want to give. My own feet to take me where you want to go. And my own story of redemption to explain your will for the world. Forgive me for waiting for better circumstances, more talent, more time, or a bigger budget. Forgive me for trying to manipulate circumstances to accomplish my will rather than yours. I am grateful that you are redeeming me from the foolish ways of the world, and I want my life to be evidence of your transforming power. May I live every day in the awareness that I have everything I need to accomplish whatever you want me to do. Lord, help me to take advantage of every situation I'm in to lift up the name of Jesus. And we pray this in the name of the one who taught us these words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to move on to our scripture for the day and then into our message. So stand by. Our scripture from this evening, we're going to turn to the Old Testament book of Isaiah. And we're going to be reading Isaiah 43, verses, 1b to verse 3a. 1b to 3a on Isaiah 43, and also part of verse 4, just the very last phrase. So Isaiah 43, beginning with verse 1b. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you go through the deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. You will walk through the fire of oppression. You will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you, for I am the Lord your God, your Savior, the Holy One of Israel, and I love you. These are the very words of God for the people of God, and your response is, thanks be to God. Now on to our message for today. Our message for today is entitled Things That Can Cause You to Be Thirsty for Jesus. And I've identified three real general categories about what might cause us to be separated from Jesus. There are, of course, many others, but these are three of the most common ones, and again, very general categories. First of all, it could be a personal or human tragedy. We lose someone special to us. We have some terrible accident that happens to someone who's close to us. Something caused us to be separated from a loved one for a reason, or for to watch, have us watch someone else or ourselves to suffer for some reason. But some kind of tragedy, and we. While some people are separated from Jesus for that, others are drawn closer to Jesus, and it kind of depends on where you are in your faith walk as to which way you go. If you're fairly early in your faith walk and your faith isn't that strong yet, something like that can kind of push you over the edge and say, you know, well, I blame God for this and I'm just moving away from him. There can't be any God since he let this happen to somebody that I care about. But for some people who are a little farther into their faith, when they have something like that, it tends to draw them closer to God and to Jesus, then it does push them away. So that's something that can make us thirsty for Jesus. Sickness is another thing. Either you or someone close to you becomes seriously ill, and you find yourself drawn closer to Jesus, clinging to your faith, if you will, to help you get through whatever this terrible problem is. I've suffered any number of those things in my 3/4 of a century of life on this earth, almost 3/4 of a century. So those two things are definitely things that cause people to be thirsty for Jesus, to try and move closer to him. And actually, this may be an oversimplification, but boredom, just not being satisfied with your life, you just feel like it's just not meaningful enough, or maybe that there's something missing from it. You're in a rut and you don't seem to be getting anywhere. And there's this nagging thing in the back of your mind that tells you that there's something missing in my life. You want something more, something to give life a little more meaning, more spice, more, well, life. So it's that particular situation that we're going to examine today. Kind of an offshoot of that might be that things are going just too well for us, and we don't feel like we need to be closer. That's kind of the reverse of this situation. It's not that life is difficult and we want to move closer to Jesus. Once in a while, we get really comfortable and we think, well, what do I need Jesus for? Things are going really well, and we don't give credit where credit's due, that maybe Jesus had something to do with that. But anyway, today we're going to take a look at this situation that sometimes we fall into where we just feel that there's something missing in our lives. There's something that should be there and it's not. And you may remember that in the past I've compared this in my own life, when I was separated from God, into being lost in the desert. I tried different pathways. I moved away from my original career and into another. And although my new work was very interesting and rewarding, much like my old career had been, there was still something missing. I tried to move into different social circles. I tried different lifestyles. And everywhere I turned, there was always this thirst in my life that I just couldn't seem to quench. Something was missing, And I finally realized that until I figured out that great mystery, I was just going to be thirsty. It only took me about 40 years of wandering in that desert. I think Moses probably could identify with that struggle. But for me to finally find that oasis that would quench my thirst. And come to find out, actually, that it was returning to my own roots where I would finally find the answer. You know that in turning around, you can actually move forward in your life. Did you know that? You can make a 180-degree turn and change in changing directions and end up moving forward instead of backward. That's one of the beauties of God and His power in our lives. I was lucky. My parents had raised me in the church. I figured that I was happy there growing up, and I wondered if returning to those roots could help. My family had attended, my immediate family had attended a local United Methodist church in our community one Christmas Eve at the invitation of some friends. Now, my eldest son was working on Sundays at that point and wasn't able to go, but I did grab my youngest son, who was then 15, and we got up on a Sunday morning and headed for Delphus Trinity United Methodist Church. We were greeted warmly, especially Charles, who had a number of friends who attended there. And I want to inject here that a common complaint I heard long before I became a pastor was that, well, I filled out one of those comment cards in the pew pocket or in the literature rack, and nobody from the church ever contacted me. I do understand that. Obviously, they put those cards in there for purpose, and if somebody's not following up on them, then that is a problem for the church. But it's always too bad when people don't get that follow-up, because I think it has cost members for churches or prospective members. However, and that's a big however, I filled out one of those cards on two separate Sundays in a row and was never contacted by anybody from that church. In reality, they weren't dying of thirst, I was. In survival training, they always teach that an individual should be as prepared as possible to rescue themselves in a life-changing, life-threatening situation, because you can't always count on help from others, especially in remote areas. I remember the story, you may have read it, of a young man that was out climbing in the mountains, and he started down a steep cliff, and as he reached out to steady himself on a rock, a huge rock above it dislodged and came down and pinned his arm to the rock below it, and he couldn't pull his arm out. He tried everything and couldn't get his arm out. And he knew that he was in a desperate situation. He was in a very remote area, and there weren't many, if any, hikers or climbers in that area. And so as he waited and waited and waited and hoped that somebody would come looking for him, he soon realized that he was going to have to be the master of his own destiny. And he ended up pulling out a pocket knife and cutting his own arm off so that he could get freed from that rock. Now, that's a drastic situation. But my situation was kind of a life or death situation too, not in the same way his was, but my life was empty and I felt like it wasn't going anywhere meaningful, and I was in a desperate situation of my own. And so you know, like that young man, I decided that I needed what this church had to offer, whether they physically came to me and offered it or not, or whether I just sat there on Sunday mornings and took it. And so we started attending regularly. And instead of waiting for somebody to contact me, I called the pastor I asked him, I said, what does the church need right now in the way of help? And he was ready with an answer. At that time, the church needed a junior high Sunday school teacher. Well, for nearly two decades of my teaching career, at that age level, I taught middle school and junior high age students. I told him they didn't have to look any farther. I'd take it. So every Sunday morning, I went in and I taught those young people about Jesus. And in teaching them about Jesus and helping them to connect with Jesus, I began to reconnect myself with Jesus. My son Charles and I also joined the choir. The church, basically what happened here is the church had extended the hand of welcome. And now it was my job to grab it and hang on to it. What has followed has been a 15-year love affair, probably longer than that now, with Jesus, rekindled by the Spirit through those kind folks at Delphus Trinity. They didn't put the Holy Spirit on me. What they offered was an environment I could go into and receive the Holy Spirit directly from God and not have to depend on them to bring that to me. They were just a vehicle. They were just providing four walls and a roof and a worshipful atmosphere and a welcoming atmosphere. They were wonderful people. I'm sure that if some of them had known that I wasn't getting a response, I'd have had one. And to those little cards. But it wasn't long before I moved from the Sunday school class to directing the choir. My friend, who would soon become my wife, was also attending, also began attending, and she became appointed to a small church in the area. She was already a pastor. And then eventually Jesus began to call me again, as he had when I was 15 years old and received a call to the ministry. And I'm not going to tell you that it's been a smooth paved pathway since then. I've had a lot of bumps in the road. I've lost family members to sickness and old age and a number of different things. I've had relationships that have broken. I've had lots of things happen. But I do know that I am happier today than I have ever been. And I feel the most secure I've ever felt, not because I'm wealthy, not because of anything that any earthly person has provided me, but I am happier and more secure than I've ever felt because I have put all my trust in God. And I've moved as close to Jesus as I can get, and I'm hoping every day to move just a little bit closer to him. I don't know if you've seen it. I've posted it on our Facebook page, so it's worth your time to go and listen to this. What a compelling testimony. There's a video that was posted by someone of a little 8-year-old girl who is blind. And the video circulating around the internet. It's had thousands and thousands of views. But she has a wonderful and compelling and an honest and sincere testimony that everybody should hear. When she related that her mother one day asked her how she feels about having Jesus in her life. And the little girl says that she's eight. I don't know if I mentioned that or not, but she said she feels peace by having Jesus in her life because she knows that now she will be healed from her blindness. And here's where Jesus says we need to become as children. She added that she doesn't know if that healing will take place in this life or in the next, in heaven. But she knows that someday she's going to be able to see again and that her eyes will be healed. That's pretty much the gist of it. And it's pretty much the gist of it for all of us. What a wonderful testimony to faith. She knows that sooner or later, her vision will be healed by having Jesus in her life, and that she's willing to wait. And it brought tears to my eyes. I thought, how many of us adults don't have that kind of an understanding of what a deep faith can provide for us? We know that no matter how rough the pathway of life becomes, better things are coming, sooner or later. And that is the hope that provides us with the joy and the strength to face what comes today and tomorrow with love in our hearts. We know that whether it's now or whether it's in the next life, that we are going to be, as Jesus put it, we can't even imagine, we can't even in our wildest imaginations understand how good that next life is going to be. And then, and I'm going to add this before I close, people say, well, then, you know, all that is, well, it's going to get better tomorrow. Today we suffer. And I say, but the difference is that if we suffer today, and Job is a good example of this in the scriptures, if we suffer today, we can have joy in our hearts by knowing that this is only temporary. And as bad as it might be, it's going to end soon. And when it does, things are going to be wonderful. So that is not just joy tomorrow, that's joy today, knowing what we have in front of us. And I'm going to end with this scripture. And lo, this is Jesus, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. That's from Matthew 28:20. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. So that's one of the reasons we need to put our, and we're the ones that are responsible for this. We need to put ourselves in positions that make us thirstier, more thirsty, I guess. I don't know if thirstier is even a word. Put ourselves in positions where we are more thirsty to draw us and give us more incentive to be even closer to Jesus. Now, that doesn't mean we make ourselves sick or anything like that, but that we generate a need for being closer to Jesus so that we can every day move a little closer to him. And that act of light program, our Lights for the Lord program, is one of the ways we do that. Because once you do something nice for somebody and you realize that you benefit from that far more than they do, that you'll want to be closer to Jesus and you'll want to be doing this. And, you know, maybe this, for some of you, this may stay a once a week thing. For others, it might become something that you do more than, you know, maybe it becomes twice a week, and then maybe it becomes three times a week. You know, those are questions you're going to have to answer as time goes on and just kind of see where the Lord leads you. Or maybe you'll just continue to do once a week. But how nice that once a week, somebody is going to have a precious gift from you in the name of the Lord. And don't forget, when you do that, tell them, God bless you. You know, this is not from me. This is from the Lord. I'm just the vehicle. That I just wanted to say that God loves you. We have our little crosses that I carry around, and with a card from Sanctuary Lakeside attached to them, to the packet. And when we see somebody that and the Spirit moves me, I hand them one of those, and I say, you know, something to the effect of, you know, Jesus loves you, or just know that we're going to be praying for you this week, or whatever the Lord moves me to say. And we hand them the cross. Last Sunday, I have some children's crosses that are made out of a Lexan plastic. They're actually pretty little crosses, different colors. And we were sitting in a church where I was a guest pastor last week, and there was a little girl behind us. I would guess she's probably 6 or 7, maybe 7 or 8. And before the service started, I asked her father if I could give her one of those little crosses. And I just turned around and I handed it to her. I said, would you like one of these? And I always, of course, have mine on. And I said, would you like one of these little crosses? And she kind of nodded, she would. And I said, here you go. And I said, whenever you see this, you remember how much Jesus loves you. And she just smiled and took it. And my heart was just filled by that. And you're going to find those things as you do these acts of light in the world. So I'm going to encourage you. I hope you participate in that. We don't get anything out of that, but you sure will. And somebody that you help or encourage is going to as well. So thank you for joining us this evening. Will you bow with me in prayer? Lord, help us to be a light for someone in our world this week. Provide us with the opportunities, and we pray that you will just lay those things out in front of us and with the people who most need it, and then help us to have the courage to respond to that call. And we thank you for your abiding presence in our lives and for all the words and messages this evening. Help us to apply those as you see fit in our lives. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to move on into our final song, which is Every Move I Make. And then we'll be back for our closing. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this evening's program. We are sure glad that you're with us. Without you, we have no purpose for being here. We just want to leave you with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Remember, we love you and God loves you, and there's nothing you can do about it. We hope that you have a pleasant rest of the week and a wonderful and safe weekend. And that, as always, until we meet again next week, that God will be the light of your path. Good night and God bless.